That's it. I just wanted to mention before we leave, one of the last things that we would like to do is gather all the folks that are here representing states and provinces outside these doors on the little deck out here and get a group picture. Something we like to do every year. Some years we forget to do that. But if you know that there's somebody that's not in the room, if you see them, remind them that we want to do that as well. We've got some time here for a wrap-up. This room is not great for roundtable conversation, as we've learned, but this is really our last opportunity to have just free and open conversation about whatever is on your mind, whether it be EV-related or whatever. Tim, you want to come out?
I'm doing helping Lisa Kuzma with the project. She used to be the fleet manager for California, deals with the TRB. And she asked me today, I had a conversation with her yesterday, are any of you having any issues with right to repair currently, as far as trying to get stuff?
We're not having issues. We just had a gentleman who has been requesting a lot of our data that we have, from Chicago area, who's waiting to this, but he's had sunshine requests, all of our data spares and repairs, because we do have John Deere software equipment, and so he's trying to figure out how we got it and others can get access to it. So we've been kind of put in a unique position on that. We've got the dealers that we work with, and we've got the software from, we've got an outside individual who's not having the software. So we're kind of trying to figure out what we can and can't. So it's got to kind of touch on for us in that respect. But we can do our repairs.
You're not suffering. Your fleet is not suffering.
Right. We just have individuals who are upset with us that have some insurance.
Is that
allowed? Yes.
Yeah, we had the same request about 6 months ago. We eventually provided the information, so it got in.
No, he has the pages of repair code that I know we could use. That code,
just,
I'm like, I don't know what to do.
We turned it to our AG, and when they came back and said, this is the information we provided, we gave it to my board, and I really just wasn't very nice about it.
Yeah.
And when I got into it a little bit, I think he's a third party that either produces or does some coding for the job here or software.
Yeah,
I sound like you may have not been getting paid.
Yes.
Or whatever is going on.
Yes.
I know you've done some research and I want to clarify what this issue about repair really means, because it is the limitations.
Okay, right, repair itself is there's tension between OEMs and people actually manufacturing products and private shops to be able to repair it. And concern. Going concern somewhat that these private shops are being shut out because they have factory software that isn't certain parts of the systems. There is a lot of private people with John Deere that cannot get the software. And again, this restricts, I guess in this country, free trade. There's been laws passed in certain states, and in Massachusetts is the latest one. Where it's like you're saying they confirm private businesses right to be able to repair anything, which confirms that ability to put the software as well as. I think the federal government, the FTC, is going to take this up pretty soon. There is a bunch of private entities and private OEM partnership entities that are going over this. This has been ongoing 2002, the Automotive Service Association had an agreement with the OEMs. In 2003, they actually turned over a ton of data on this and allowed a lot of people in. But since then, there's been some tension between all of the interested parties in this. You know, what comes next is an arm's length agreement. It's, you know, it's literally verbal agreement, but there is no official legislation or anything that confirms any of this. So there's no teeth to it if the OEMs go back on board. But it's like, we are suffering, anybody in any state is suffering. You know, you can't repair it, you can't get the software or something like that. We're, you know, at the TRB this winter, there's going to be a veteran session, potentially August, and we're going to try to pull in some of these, the OEMs and some of the, these private concerns and see what's going on. But it's just, if it hasn't reached us yet, hopefully it does. Sorry, you're going through that.
It was, I mean, it was just one of those things that we did not think was going to be a big issue because we were not having problems as far as the department working. It was, you know, a third party individual who looked exactly sure it's the same guy because it was like, yeah, Pat, it was his dad, Pat, or nothing. It was some little story. But he came into our office, wanted to see what software we had, what access we had on our software, and all of our programs. He didn't think it was fair. As a state agency, that we have anything more than a farmer could have. So basically, he was treating us like a dealership. I mean, he was like, how did the dealership give that to you? And he's like, well, we went out for bid, and we don't have it through John Deere Corporate, we have it through the dealership. And so we don't want to burn a bridge with Myers because, I mean, they go out of their way for us. So.
Either current or future DOT, use that charger effectively. Is anybody doing anything other than
the answer for us is yes. And that could put me in the reservoir statute that what if they put it on a facility for 1 year is great.
And you put it on a facility.
We have 12 that sit right along, and I can see from home that sit right along. We have a commuter parking lot. It's on our facility. It's right there. Actually, we have a town of Weathersfield comes over and charges their 2 mile police vehicles. There's people that are parked all the time, all weekend. We have other ones in the back of the parking lot that employees use because they're kind of like the national. But anything that's visible, I mean, has public access. If we put it in, it's free for a year.
Free for a year.
Free for a year.
Air for connected DOT vehicles, or it is?
So we do. Our motor pools we have set up for at the main building for vehicles in the building that is getting touched right now. We're either getting a new building or reefer is having infrastructure put in for charging, and we will supply where the employees park. There'll be, you know, they go by how many people are at the building. If there's 10 people over 2 chargers, parking plus chargers for any state vehicles as well.
Go ahead.
I was just going to comment. This is slightly off the second point, but in North Carolina, we're not exactly the most green state in the world. In North Carolina and all the big counties in North Carolina, including one I am, you can't build a multifamily structure without building a charging station. It's in the code, it's in the building code, that you gotta have electric charging capacity for your apartments, any kind of public buildings, you gotta have a building with some capacity for electric charging.
Can I have a gas stove?
Plug in their diesel trucks, like their pickup trucks, and we tell them you can't even do that, so I can't imagine what Missouri.
So I'm with you on this. We've taken the position that the union will eat us for lunch if we start giving away electric fuel and not diesel fuel and gasoline. And then the conversation went, well, we'll give it at a reduced rate, okay? We're going to give it at a reduced cost for diesel fuel and gas, and then it morphed to, well, it's a convenience thing. I said, okay, you're going to provide convenience to the others. And then they said, we have more work to do. So we could have done these union issues before, but there are other state agencies that are allowing it in certain situations. I don't think the union is as strong to push back, but it's probably.
Is that what you'll still allow?